Okay, hi everyone. So today we'll continue with elementary programming, and I believe that this time we'll probably have also time to get into selections a little bit. Okay, so basically we'll continue with the second chapter of our textbook. Please feel free at any point to ask me, to stop me and ask me any questions, both in the chat or in by unmuting yourself and asking the question. So last time, if you remember, we basically changed the change maker, this program that computes the change in a sense for a specific amount between 1 and 99 cents, into a change maker for any kind of change in dollars. So if you remember, we changed the input to be dollar input. We were asking the amount that needs to be paid, what kind of bills were given back, like the amount from which we want to pay that original amount or bill. And then we took the change and we distributed into $20, $10, $5, $1 bills and the different kind of quarters, coins, quarters, dimes, nickels, and pennies. So that was what we did last time. And now we continue with one more program, computing the area of a circle. Again, it's just an example to show what we discussed last time. We defined two variables, radius and area, of the type double. The radius is assigned, it's initialized with 20. We compute the area as the radius square multiplied with the value of pi, or a constant that represents an approximation of pi, and we display the results. In our case, this is the area of the circle of that given radius is the area. Okay. And if we want to trace this program, and I will show you that in a few seconds in the Eclipse, basically you put a breakpoint at the beginning of the program and then you see what happens step by step. So just a second, please. Okay, I'm sorry. My dog started to eat some furniture. So basically we put a breakpoint when we define the double variable radius, and then we can execute the program line by line. So when that radius is defined, we have an allocation of memory for that variable. When the next variable area is defined, we also allocate memory for the second variable. Then we assign to the radius the value 20. That basically modifies that location in memory to store the integer, the double 20. Similarly, when the area is assigned the value, it changes from no value into the value actually corresponding to a circle with area with radius of 20. And finally, we basically display the result. And you can do this entire program in Eclipse to actually trace it. And that's probably the most important part, that you should learn the tracer. It's extremely important that you know how to trace a program, because that's the way that we debug programs. So let's create a class. Compute area. And we can put a breakpoint, as I basically said. We can put it here in when we assign the first value to radius. And we start the debugger. So now we can actually see line by line what's basically happening. So we can assign the value to the radius. You can actually see that it modified. Now the radius is 20. Similarly, we assign the area value, and you can step through to print out the result. And basically, after this concatenation of the area of the string with the radius and the area is executed, we can see the output. every time you basically want to trace your program, you can basically start the tracer based on the breakpoints. Once you know how the program runs, you can basically disable those breakpoints because they are not needed anymore, or you can just remove them. So now, what exactly we did in our program for the actually the change maker. We created the scanner object. A scanner object is used in Java for reading any kind of input from the command prompt or console. So we create an object of the type scanner. This scanner class is in Java util package. When you start any Java program, by default, you only have the classes that are in the java.lang package. If you want other packages, you must import them. So in the case of the scanner, it's imported from the Java util scanner. And I will tell you more about packages in a few seconds. The advantage of having a scanner is that now you can use the methods available in that class to read different types of data. So next method returns the string up to any kind of white space. That includes spaces, new lines, tabs, any kind of basically white space characters. A new byte will actually let you read a variable in a byte. A next short will let you read a variable in a short variable. Next int will let you read an integer. Next long lets you read a long. Next float will let you read numbers that are floats. Next double will let you read doubles. Next boolean to read a boolean literal, either true or false. So let me actually show you these examples. So we need a test file. We first create a scanner input for the standard input, system.in. And there are three different ways to use a class that is not in Java lang. One way is to precede actually the class with the package. So one way is to just write java.util.scanner input is equal with a new java.util.scanner. And this is fine. This eliminates that error. You're basically prefixing the class with where that class is found. Okay. Another way to use a class is to actually import it in the user module, into the current user module in which this program is executed. So you can import java.util.scanner, and now you can use scanner basically in the current user module. The advantage to have it in the previous way in which you basically prefix the class with the package name is that you can actually use two different scanner classes from two different packages. So there is no ambiguity when you use scanner, which one you use. So that's the case, for instance, different packages. Like for instance, if you have drivers for databases like SQL, you want to use a driver from MySQL and a driver from Postgres, they have the same name. You can actually prefix that class with the package, the driver package for MySQL or for Postgres. So there are basically three different ways, I said, for using classes. One is to prefix the class with the package from where you want to use it. Second one is to import only that class into the current user space. The third way is to import all classes from that package, java.util.star. That star means any class from that package, bring it to the user, the space. Okay. So in my opinion, basically you should be precise. So you should actually import what classes you use into the current user space. Don't import all, because in java.util there are about 100 classes. If you only want to use one of them, I see no point to import all of them. Now your user space contains 100 classes instead of just one that you wanted from that package. So let's continue. So we imported scanner, we created an input object that can read from the user, and now you can basically use the different methods. So if you have a byte, you can use input.nextByte. If you have a short, then you can use input.nextShort. If you want to actually read an integer, you can use input.nextInt. If you want to use to read a long, you can use input.nextLong. Now, if you want to read strings, there are two methods. So if you want to just read string by string, so for instance, if I would enter the area of the circle, if you just want to read word by word the area for the circle and so on, you can basically do it in a loop and you can use the next method. So S1 is equal with input.next. So this reads only the first word of that sentence. If you want to read the entire line, then S2 is input.nextLine. If you want to read the Boolean, you would use input.nextBoolean. Now, basically, let me show you. Next Boolean, it tells me that this doesn't exist. Oh, B, I already used it for byte, B2. Okay, so let's actually test this program. We'll test it line by line and we'll see what each one of these does. Let me put a breakpoint and start the debugger. So now I enter a byte, like for instance, 12. Actually, let's read this. So now you can see that B is basically 12. Now I want to enter a short. So a short is longer than a byte, let's say 150. It cannot be stored in a byte. And we can see that S is basically 150. Next, we want to read an integer. So we can enter 12,000. That's an integer value. And it read an integer. Next, it wants to read a long value. So a long value is some big number, which as you can see, we read it. You can't read it in an integer. It's too long, too big to be stored on 32 bits an integer. Now, let me show you how do you read strings. So let's say the red circle is of an area of 20. So in the variable S1, we only have the first word. So it's up to the white space. So it only read the, meaning that the cursor for reading is actually right before the red circle of area of 20. So now if we actually continue, it read, oops, I actually run it to the end. So let's put again, let's stop it, start again the debugger. I will execute it up to that point. So let's move the breakpoint here and continue. So now we read the byte. So we had 12. Not exactly sure what's happening. Let's see. The breakpoint is there. So a short is 150. Next integer, we said that we have 12,000. Then we have for the long, a very long value. Then we have the red circle is of an area of 20. And now you can actually see. So S1 was just the, and S2 is red circle or is of an area of 20. So really basically what happened, it if you use next, it reads up to the next white space. If you use next line, it reads the rest of the line, the entire line from the current position of the cursor up to the end of the line. Okay. And let's continue the program. So now it's waiting for a Boolean. So we are going to enter true. And that was red. And in fact, the B2 contained that Boolean value. Any questions about scanner and the methods available in scanner? So there are two questions in the chat. Control or command shift plus O, does the missing imports for you? Yes, that's true. It's basically the same when you're forgetting an import and you go with the mouse over, and it basically allows you to select what do you want to import. And that's the only question that I can see. Any other questions? Okay, good. So now let's talk about packages. So one thing that we had to do in the case of scanner is to import a class from a package that is not by default available in the user space. The idea is that in order to make easier to find and use and avoid name conflicts, if you have a class in two different with the same name in two different packages, if you try to import the two classes, you will have an error. Basically, it will tell you that you can't have two things that are named the same in the user space. So programmers bundle multiple classes into packages or modules. In other languages, they are called modules. In Java, they are called packages. The types that are available when you start your program are only those that are in the package java.lang. For anything else, you need to import them. And there are many different packages available in Java. For instance, java.util contains math and scanner. java.io contains printwriter and other classes basically used for input and output from files, and so on. You can also put your classes in your own packages. So basically, you can use the default package like we were using in the case of default classes, like the class that we wrote test, or you can actually create a class in a specific package. So this is not available by default in other packages. Only if you import them from that package, they will be available. So this Hello CSE 160, if I want to use it in our test, it won't be available by default. I can try Hello CSE 160H, as defining a variable and doesn't know where is it. If I want to import it, then I have to import it. I have to specify that I want to import from CSE 160, hello CSE 160, that class that I was using, okay? And there are three different ways to import. So basically creating packages, it basically creates such a package and it creates a directory structure, EDU, then within EDU folder, Stony Brook, and within that, the class, the package that you want, CSE 114 or CSE 160. To use such a public package, a member, like a class from another package, you have three different options. You can refer by that member by its fully qualified name. So you can precede the class name with the package name, both when you are defining variables and when you are initializing those variables. Like for instance, you see it here, java.util.scanner, input is equal with a new java.util.scanner, again, of system input. So you have to precede it everywhere with the package name, or you can import only that one package member by putting at the beginning of your program this import statement, import java.util.scanner, or you can import the entire package So that imports the scanner and also any other class that is available in that package, like for instance, the math class and so on. Sometimes it may be useful to write this, because if you do use all the classes in that package, then you should import them all at once. And then basically all those names are brought into the current user space. But in most cases, you should enumerate what classes you are using. It's a very useful way to actually even see what classes are used instead of importing all of them. Packages appear to be hierarchical when you write things like package edu stonybrook.cse114 or CSE160. They appear to be hierarchical. You have like a set of links. And in fact, when they are stored on the hard drive, they appear to be hierarchical. You have an EDU folder. Within the EDU folder, you have a Stony Brook folder. Within that folder, you have a CSE114 folder. But in fact, they are not. So when you import, for instance, java.awt.star, it imports all the members of java.awt. However, it doesn't import colors, which are in java.awt.color, or fonts, which are in java.awt.font, and so on. So if you want to import the classes at different levels in that hierarchy, in that folder hierarchy, you should have different multiple lines, one in which imports java.awt.star, one that imports java.awt.color.star. And this is why it's useful to actually state what are you importing from every one of those packages. Because otherwise, one would make the mistake to think that when you import one hierarchy like java.awt.star, you import everything under it, which is totally wrong. You basically only import the members at that level, only that level. Another thing to know about class paths is that packages is that, in fact, those packages that are available for import are those that are actually in the environment variable called class path. So there is a system environment variable called class path, which contains the locations of all of the packages, or basically the folders that may contain packages, Java packages on your system. So for instance, if you want that a package, let's say that George gives me a package and I want to use it, that folder where George's packages are stored must be actually added to class path variable. So for instance, on Windows, you would do that with set, and then the class path location where you want class path equal the location where those packages are found. On Unix-based operating systems, you can do the set method, but that doesn't actually set the class path variable. You can basically export that class path once you are done setting it. Okay, and that's really something that is different on different operating systems. It's actually a difference in the scripting language used for the different operating systems than actually the set of that variable, the way that that variable acts in the presence of Java. Any questions? In my case, the chat tends to disappear. Okay, so next reads up to any white space. Andrew is right. Next line, he reads the entire line up to the new line character. One other thing is actually that the new line character actually is it's different between Windows and Linux again. So on Windows, its new line is /r, which is carriage return. And on Linux is new line /n/r. So basically it's, in Java, this is standardized again. So when you have a /n, it really means new line. It's not only the new line, but also carriage return. So these are, again, differences between different operating systems. The good part about Java is that it standardizes that /n, which we'll talk about in a couple of minutes, is new line. And then depending on what operating system you are on, it it actually materializes with a different new line character or characters. Okay, constants. So they are similar to variables. The difference is really that we are using this modifier final in front of the identifier definition. So when we define a variable, we had data type, then the name of that variable. And if we wanted, we initialized it with some value. The only difference with constants is that we use also the final keyword in front of the definition of that data type. So as you can basically see here, final double pi is equal with 3.141549, defines the constant pi. So it tells us that this identifier, once is assigned a value, it's final. It cannot be modified. It will be a syntax error if you try to assign a different value later to pi. One thing to keep in mind is that you actually don't need to define and initialize in the same line a constant. It's customary to do so, but you can define final double pi, semicolon, and later pi is equal with 3.14159. So you can actually split the declaration with the initialization of that constant. Another thing that is quite customary is to use only uppercase letters in the identifier for a constant. So this actually started with Fortran, in which there was no concept of constants. There was no way syntactically to define that an identifier is a constant. And what people did in order to standardize that, just reading the name of the identifier, you know that that's a constant, is to use only uppercase letters. So in Java is not a requirement, but it is a style that constants only use uppercase letters. Or the constant name is all uppercase letters. So here there are two examples. Final double pi is that value and final integer size is 3. So this is how you define constants. Next, characters. So basically characters, as I mentioned earlier, are those variables that contain a single character within single quotes in Java. And these characters can be written in two different ways. If you have the character on your keyboard, you can basically define the variable and assign to that variable the character within single quotes. So this is usually customary for ASCII codes and all of the codes that you have on your keyboard. You can't actually have characters to type characters that are not on your keyboard. You can copy them with Command-C or Control-C from some email, let's say, and you can drop them if your editor lets you actually use Unicode and paste it into your program. But the other way is actually to use the Unicode encoding for that character. So for instance, if you know the encoding for A, you can actually use the escape character, which is the backward slash U, and then the Unicode for that. It's customary to have four characters for Unicode. So 0041 is actually the Unicode for the decimal number, the hexadecimal for the decimal number 65, and 65 is the encoding of uppercase A. Similarly, slash U0034 in hexadecimal is the encoding for 4. Basically, is the character code, the Unicode code for 4. Now, one thing to know about characters is that characters can be interpreted as numbers, because as we can see, they are in fact numbers stored as numbers. So you can use the increment decrement operators on char. You can assign to a character letters and then basically use the increment and decrement to actually increment from lowercase a to lowercase b. So that's totally fine. You can even just when you assign, instead of assigning the character, you can assign the Unicode and cast it to character. So for instance, let me show you an example. So in our test class, let me assign a character car s c is equal with car of 65. So basically this is the Unicode for uppercase A. So if I system out print the character, it will basically print uppercase A. Okay. Another thing that you can do, if you want to know the Unicode for that character, you can convert it now back to integer or assign it to a variable of the type integer. So basically now we see the character A, uppercase A, has the Unicode 65. So you can do both ways. You can assign to a character an integer after you cast it. And this is an explicit cast that you must have because integer is bigger, it's 4 bytes, while car is actually just 2 bytes by default. You can do the opposite. You can define an integer and assign the character directly. You have automatic casting because basically a character is just represented as internally as an integer. So this is the way to basically convert from integer to car and from car to integer. Really internally a character is stored as an integer. And the other way that I showed you was instead of just using car C is uppercase A, say C is equal with the Unicode for A. I happen to know from the slides, as you saw before, that the Unicode for A, 65 in hexadecimal, is 41 because it's 4 multiplied with 8. That's 64 plus 1. So really it's 4 multiplied with 16 plus 1 is 65. Okay. So either one of these is a way to initialize characters. So the third one was the one that we had initially. 65 casted to a character is also uppercase A. All of these are uppercase A. Any questions? Okay. So Java internally uses Unicode UTF-16, which is a 16-bit or 2 bytes encoding for Unicode. So Unicode takes 2 bytes. And if you want to represent 2 bytes, you basically 2 bytes, you can represent them by using this escape character slash U, and then 4 hexadecimals. Each hexadecimal stands for 4 bits. So really 16-bit can be encoded with 4 hexadecimals. And you can enumerate all the characters from Unicode 0000 to Unicode FFFF, which really is 65,531 different characters. And you can see these examples are the Greek letters, alpha, beta, gamma, are from 03B1 to 03B3. And you can find the Unicode encodings for all the letters that you can think of in different alphabets, in different languages. Now, in addition to the ones that you can enumerate, there are also the special characters. So for instance, if you want to represent in a string the tab character, let's say that you are building a table and you want to have the name of the student followed by the age, and the ages should be aligned at the same column. One way to do it is to actually use the tab character. So slash T is the tab character, or you can use the Unicode encoding, which is actually the character with Unicode 9. Line feed or new line is basically the slash N character, or the character at Unicode 10, 000A. the backslash. So if you want the backslash to be actually represented, you can't just put one slash, one backslash, because the problem is that now it's that's the escape character. So it's expecting another character afterwards. So if you want the backslash itself, you would use backslash backslash. Similarly, if you have a character, you can't use single quote, because if you put single quote by itself, that's the end of the character. It ends the beginning of the single quote character. So if you want to represent single quote, you will basically have to escape it. And similarly, if you have strings and you want double quote inside the string, you would have to escape it again with the escape character. So let me show you some examples. So first thing, let's say that I want to have a table and I want it well aligned. So I have the name and then I have the age of the person. So I can do that with tabs. So let's say that Paul. Actually, I don't want to use Paul. So Peter, I can't slash T. And now let's say that Peter is 32. And John is 23. So when we run it, we can basically see that the ages are lined up, because here we have that tab character. It's a single character, which basically adjusts to the same column, okay? So that's the tab character. Now, let's assume that I want to actually print a new line after each one of these. I don't want to use println. I can put slash n. Slash n is the new line explicitly. So instead of using println, I'm actually printing new lines after each one of those lines. So now you see Peter, 32, new line, John, 23, new line, and it goes to the next line. Now I want actually to print the character for single quote. I'm going to use escape and then the single quote. So now I see that actually I did represent the character single quote. And similarly for double quotes. So if this is a string, but I want to have inside the string the double quote character, I have to escape it, because otherwise it would think that this double quote ends the beginning double quote. So now basically you see here I have double quotes. And the same for backslash. So if I want to actually have a backslash, I need to escape it, because backslash is used for as an escape character. So I basically have to have two backslashes in order to have one backslash in a character. Similarly, in a string, I would have to escape it with backslash. So if this would be a string, still I also have some auto-completion by the editor. I basically, one backslash can be represented by using two backslashes in the code. Okay, those are the special characters. Now, if you want to change from character to numeric types, you can basically do it easily. To an integer I, you would assign the character directly. It's the same with basically casting that character to an int. Because of the fact that the character internally is stored as a short, basically as 2 bytes, is basically you can assign it directly to the integer variable. And similarly, if you want to assign a character 97 to C, you can assign it directly. I don't believe that this is quite correct. So let me actually test it. It is. Okay. Because I thought that because of the fact that a car is represent a number is an integer by default, in order to assign it to a character, you need to cast it first to a car. But it seems that actually this is something that Java accepts directly without having to do it manually, which now I know it makes sense because this Unicode 16 encoding is a variable encoding, because basically usually Unicodes are not only 14 bits, but are up to 32 bits. So maybe based on the fact that this is a variable encoding, it allows you to actually do directly assign numbers to characters, even if they are a number is longer than just a pure character. So it may make sense. I'm sorry for that. I thought that that is not always the case. Any questions? Okay, good. So from time to time, I have to return back to, because I don't see the chat, if there are any questions. So when you develop a program, the process of developing a program is called software development, and actually is part of a multiple step process. Designing the program, basically try to think about what the problem says, understand and define the problem, determine what is required as input and what is the required output, find an algorithm or design an algorithm that solves that problem, usually at an abstract level, you write it in pseudocode, and then implement that algorithm from pseudocode into a programming language like Java. Usually nobody writes perfect programs. You basically have to debug it and testing it with different inputs. There are two methodologies used in testing. One is black box testing, usually done by a different team. So a different team than the development team starts actually testing the program with extreme conditions, like basically what are the places where the program may fail. The second type of testing is called white box test, white glass testing or white box testing, in which the same team that actually implemented the program, they test it by looking by trying those extreme conditions in which they know that they have if statements that may have multiple execution paths. So these are basically different ways to test your software. Once you are happy with the software and you deploy it on some hardware, usually the writing of the program is followed by updates and maintenance. Nobody writes perfect software. In fact, as we know, there most software are possibly that they have bugs. So it's quite often the fact that you put about 20% of effort to develop the initial solution, and then you need another 80% to maintain it. So in the price charged usually for software, maintenance is included. Maintenance may follow multiple years after the software was developed and deployed. Now, also when we talk about software engineering, we have to talk about programming style and documentation. So since programs last for a very long time after they are developed, usually programmers have to follow the same style and documentation. So use comments everywhere you actually write programs. Use good names, like for instance, we talked about camel casing. It's just easier and appropriate names for the variables that you use. It's easier for programmers that follow you or even yourself after a period of time that you forgot what you implemented to understand what every variable means. Use proper indentation and spacing. And one trick that you probably will learn quite soon is the fact that even if your program is wrongly indented, you can select everything, and then there is a shortcut Command Shift F, or there is the source format or correct indentation. So that will basically correct your indentation, so you can easily see your program or somebody else's program. If you want to actually understand it easier, what it's about. So use proper indentation, use the same block style for the entire program. So there is the end of line block style or beginning of line block style. I personally prefer end-of-line block style because it makes your program more compact, but some programmers prefer the end-of-line block style. Again, I would like if you follow up the end-of-line block style because that's what is currently used in most Java programs. So let's take an exercise like ChangeMaker. It's the program that we implemented last class and we modified it to actually take dollars as inputs. So let's assume that the problem is that you have to give somebody change. And you first you have to identify what coins do you give that person. If it's only cents, 1 to 99, basically what kind of coins do you have available? Quarters, dimes, nickels, and pennies are what we basically have usually. There are also, if you think about, there are dollar coins or some kind of other coins. There are $2 coins too, which can be used. But let's use only the standard coins that are usually available. Requirements for this problem are take the user input, the number of cents that need to be returned, and display the change breakdown as an output. Usually we want to use the minimum number of coins. So we basically want first to give all the quarters that are available for that specific amount, then the dimes, then the nickels, and then the pennies. So basically the first step in this waterfall model used in software engineering is requirement analysis. Understand and define the problem. Ask the user or the company that hired you for the input and the possible output. So they will tell you that use these US coins, quarters, dimes, nickels, and pennies. And the maximum change that is returned in coins is 99 cents. And once the user enters an input, you display this minimum number of coins, minimum set of coins to actually return the correct change. So what's involved in this requirement analysis step? Interviewing the user, the company that hired you, what are their expectations, what data do they need to access or you need to access, and write a report called the requirement analysis report. There are standard formats that basically are used for this kind of reports. One that comes to mind is the IEEE requirement analysis report or requirement specification. There are also standard visual diagrams that are used. There are the UML diagram called use case diagram is the one that is used to actually specify how the user interacts with the system. What are the inputs? What are the outputs? Next step in developing software is basically determining the input and output. So the user basically enters a number in this case as the input between 1 and 99, and the printed output usually contains the number of quarters, the number of dimes, the number of nickels, and the number of pennies. Then we usually design an algorithm, and this is usually written in some pseudo natural language, like a control natural language language. So how many quarters? You basically write a little algorithm that extracts the quotient of the division with 25. How many dimes? You take the rest, the remaining amount, and you divide it again to find the quotient after division with 10. So after you use the quarters, you may use 1 or 2 dimes to actually find the number to return the exact change, the minimum number of coins for that change. Then you may actually have to use a nickel to return the remaining amount less than 10, or after you take the remainder after division with 10. Again, you subtract that number of nickels, which usually is 0 or 1, and you have the rest, which is returned as pennies. So a pseudocode is usually some language that is similar to a programming language, but is much more simplified. You don't need to put the type of variables. It's kind of like Python, if you look at it, but it's a little bit, even in Python, you have to declare classes and statements like print and things like that. In a pseudocode, you don't need to. You just write either pseudocode or flowchart. You basically show the steps as boxes and arrows from the beginning of the program to the end of the program. So this is pseudocode. Pseudocode is interpreted from top to bottom. And then you start implementing the code. So you have the solution in pseudocode. You write it in Java or Python or C or any other programming language that you want. And this is the solution for that program in Java. If you think that the program is not correct, or you have some cases in which you don't get the correct answer, you basically have to implement this program in Java and then debug it. So this is the extended version of the changemaker, in which we take the amount in dollars, multiply it with 100, cast it with integer, and you get the remaining amount in cents. And then you basically find the number of $1 bills by dividing by 100, and then you continue. So you return everything in $1 bills over $1, and everything else, you compute the number of quarters, dimes, nickels, and pennies. And you can execute it line by line. So you define the variable and initialize it, and then you define the number of dollars and compute the number of dollars by dividing what with 100. And then you basically find the number of quarters and so on. So the idea is that you can trace the program line by line to see what does it do and how does it work. Any questions? So we have about 20 minutes left. I will stop this recording.